My name is Senator Jim Dabakis. I am giving you an official greeting for 33 seconds or less. And Speaker Hughes has told me if I go over 33 seconds, I have to make up to $29 million. So I'm going to keep it really, really short. I just wanted to
afford it too, by the way.
So I need to just have a moment because I picked up this suit a couple of weeks ago from Nordstrom's, which we all love and love and we support. And when I picked up this at Nordstrom's, I didn't notice until today that my dear friends at Nordstrom's played a little joke on me. Look at this. I swear I didn't know about this. I just opened it today. Look what that suit says.
Ah, President Trump. Look at that. It's a beautiful suit.
That's exactly what they put up there. It says President Trump on there. So I think Hughes may have something to do with it. Okay, so I just want to say two quick things. First of all, welcome. Welcome, 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 welcome. We're so glad to have you involved. First, I spent about 2 hours recently at the homeless youth shelter. And so if you're short, which I'm sure most of you aren't because you're here, but if you're short on the compassion side, go and look at those 29 young people who were there in that center, which our community and our nation and our state and the LDS Church and the homosexuals and everybody got together, rolled up our sleeves, we forgot about everything, and we built the damn thing, and I'm so proud of our community for doing that. That's what we need to do. It's beautiful. Now, some nights, a lot more than 29 young people come, and the children have to decide who's gonna go and who isn't gonna go, and there's a lottery and it's difficult. So we still have a ways to go, but it's not just a facility, it is a life-transforming kind of place, and that's where we need to go, that's where our eye needs to be, that's what the prize is. And I want to tell each of these politicians up here how proud I am of them. In Washington and everywhere else to kick problems down the road. That's what we do. That's what we do. We don't solve them. When they get really hard, when they get really difficult, when there are homeless people that are taking over neighborhoods, when businesses are going out, when there's crime, when there's police issues, politicians walk away. And they pretend it's not there and they move on to easier things. Look at these people. They didn't do it. They're not doing it. The easy road, the popular road, the way to get reelected and applauded all the time is just walk away. None of them did it. So they may disagree from time to time, but on this issue, they deserve our love, our admiration, our respect, and our continued support because they're in there in the trenches and they're fighting to make it happen. Look, Hughes is wrong on every other thing. But on this, his soul and his heart is just perfect. So I want to welcome you. I want to welcome you again. I want to say thank you for coming. Keep the spirit up. Make the questions hard. Math questions are particularly juicy for political leaders. And keep the spirit up. Keep the vision alive. Keep the dream alive, which is we're going to have communities that are revitalized and are wonderful, and we're also going to take care of this great problem. You're going to make it happen. And you're going to lead the way. And, oh, Senator Urquhart, I forgot to say thank you, too. Steve Urquhart, he just moved up here from St. George because the weather's better here, and we're very glad to have him in Salt Lake. So thank you all very much.
Thank you. you very much, Senator Dabakis. There's only one Jim Dabakis, thank God. Okay, that was fantastic. And let me echo, to start off, how I appreciate these leaders. So I was in the legislature for 16 years. Now I'm just a has-been politician and Joe Q citizen. And I've seen a lot of political leaders, so-called leaders, run from tough issues, and none of these folks are running. And you know, I'd like to thank County Mayor Ben McAdams for catching the vision on this, saying that something had to happen and got us going in the right direction a few years ago. And you know, I think has put good vision to this. And Speaker Hughes and Representative Romero just jumped in and realized that this is a statewide issue, and the state is coming to help out with this, and really appreciate that. And Mayor Biskupski, you'll remember she even campaigned on this issue and is delivering on that by working very hard. So those are the last compliments that these folks will receive tonight. My job is to press them, and you, I hope, will help with that. We have no cards at the end and pens if you want to write a question. So far I've received 4, and they're all very good, and I think that I will be able to fit those in, so thank you for that. The only thing I would like to add before we get going is, you know, I was gonna talk about the situation around the Rio Grande area. I think I'll let these folks describe that, but it's something, we have humans who are in need of something different, we have businesses who are in need of something different. We need to move forward on this. But I do want to say that a lot of money is being spent on this. People say, you know, what's being done? County alone is spending some $22 million on homeless services, $100 million on the jail. The state is throwing in $18 million for services. Private individuals in the state, some $12 million. The city is throwing in about $15 million when you look at policing, ambulances, and what they're doing on this. So it's not that these entities are avoiding the issue in any way. They are focusing on it, but we're doing it at great expense, and maybe we can do it in a way that really shows some results. So let's go ahead and, enough for me, let's hear from these leaders. I'd like to start out, let's go ahead and, Mayor Biskupski, if we can, so again, thank you all for being here, for buckling up and facing the public as you do many, many times on these issues, but I think it's a neat opportunity to have everyone together. There will be some finger pointing, because that's the thing, at some point we need to come together on this, and that's difficult for different governmental entities, and you're going to have some finger pointing necessarily, that, well, we would move forward if this other entity would do that. That's a healthy part of the process, but then we have to come together and say, okay, I agree, I'm doing this, you're doing that. And so let's see if we can move a bit more in that direction. So I would like each one to take a few minutes and describe how you see the situation, what you think is going on, describe it in any way you want, and where you think that we should be going with this. So kind of a broad overview, and then with each round of questions, we'll dig a little more into the weeds. Mayor.
So currently in Salt Lake City, we have selected 4 sites for resource centers. That was a unanimous decision made by the city council and myself. That decision still stands firm. And then we also have launched our Salt Lake City housing strategy, which is a key component to the work that has to get done in order for us to be successful in helping people who are experiencing homelessness. That is on the web now for review. It's Grow SLC. We have also launched the Blue Ribbon Commission for Housing. This commission is made up of people from the financial industry and from the development industry. We spoke with Utah Housing Corporation today. It sounds like they will join that team to really help us create a new partner in how we finance affordable housing in Salt Lake City. So that is a very exciting tool that we'll be working on this year as well. In Salt Lake City, we are still partnering with the county and the state on the funding of services and also getting these resource centers built. And we also, as a city, are going to match some funds coming from the county to make sure the Operation Diversion continues through 2017. So that'll be in my budget moving forward, and I hope the council supports that. So is that helpful?
Thank you, that's great. I'm actually gonna change the order. Let's go city to county to state. So Mayor McAdams, hopefully you had formulated your thoughts and are ready to go.
Well, thank you. You know, first of all, I wanna say Senator Backus in his intro, I've heard that several times now where they say, you know, nobody else has ever jumped into this, and congratulations to these people for jumping in. And every time I hear that, I think, wait a minute, why didn't somebody tell me it was an option to not jump into this? Because here we are, right, Mayor Biskupski, here we are, and but anyway, here we are. And oftentimes these aren't challenges of our making, but we're all here from the state to the city to the county working to solve it. And so I want to compliment our partners. Mayor Biskupski has jumped headlong into this, and she's doing really hard work and making some hard decisions, and I applaud her for that. Speaker Hughes, I want to say how incredible it is to have a speaker of the Utah House of Representatives who is owning this problem, who's working side by side with us to find solutions, and we are making incredible headway. I also joke that, you know, I've never worked so hard on an issue where there's unanimous consent to move forward, and it still is hard, even though everybody agrees that we're moving forward and we have to address this, and it is still hard. But it's exciting that we're here and we're working together, and you'll probably hear some disagreement tonight. You've heard some disagreement through the media, and I wanna reassure my constituents, that's healthy. That is the process. We talk, we work through it, and that process of discussing our disagreements is how we find agreement. So one of the things that brings me to this, I want to tell about two people. One is a young girl who, she and her father came to meet with me when they heard, this has been about a year, heard about the work we were doing to address challenges around the shelter. And her father wanted to come because he is a single parent raising his daughter, and they've had been spending some time in the shelter. And he wanted to come and tell me about some of the challenges that they were facing there. And he had been assaulted. He had a small construction business, and when some things happened that were unexpected, he lost the construction business, went bankrupt, and found himself and his daughter in the shelter. And talk about the challenges that relates to the shelter and the people who are there to prey upon the most vulnerable in our community. And I oftentimes think of that small family, the father trying to raise a daughter. I think she was about 4 or 5 years old, the fear that she must feel seeing violence and crime and fights break out around her and hearing the sounds she must hear in the shelter every night. And I think we can do better by that family. I also think about Pete Henderson, who owns the Rio Grande Cafe. And Pete's trying to maintain a business that he's run for years, a historic business to keep it functioning in our community, an incredible asset for our community. And some of the challenges he faces as he just tries to make ends meet. And I think of both of those people, and I think for those people, we can do better. So over the last couple of years, as we've been trying to analyze the problem, we started mapping the genome of homeless services to understand the system. Before we can try and improve and fix some of the challenges we're seeing, we had to understand the system. So we spent about 6 months mapping the genome of homeless services, understanding where the funding comes into the system, what happens when that, and where the funding is coming from, what happens with the services once they enter the system, and then people. How do people come into the homeless services system? What happens to them once they enter the system? And then how do they leave the system? What works? How do they leave successfully, and how can we amplify that? And where do they leave unsuccessfully and maybe relapse into shelter at some point in the future? And how do we avoid that? So we went through this process of trying to understand homeless services, and we have come to the conclusion that we can do better, that we can help more people exit successfully, that we can help families and children in homelessness to divert them from shelter, to avoid homelessness for our families. We can help those who are in crisis, to get them to a place of healing where they can begin their journey to healing, where they can begin a journey to independence and a greater degree of self-reliance. And that's where we're on right now. So that's where we came forward with the recommendations of scattered sites where we can break up the population from one size fits all large shelter to one that focuses on individual populations and how we can help those populations be in a place where they receive the services that will help them to heal from whatever caused them to be in crisis to begin with. And it's going to require us to be data-driven and very deliberate in the actions we take. And that's not easy. I want to commend the homeless service providers who have been at this for decades, working so hard on the front lines. And you know, as I talk about reforming a system and changing a system, I'm always quick to say, to admit that we have providers who have been on the front lines doing incredible work, and we are moving the goalposts on those providers. To no fault of their own, I think oftentimes they are doing exactly what we ask them to do, and we're changing what we ask them to do. And they've been incredible. We've been meeting in our collective impact meeting with these people for over 2 years now. On a monthly basis, we have 75 to 100 people who show up at our collective impact meeting, and we're working closely with them to really reform the system, to reform the homeless services system. They've been patient as we've been patient with them, and they've been patient as we work together through this. And I'm here today with optimism that there is support from our speaker, from highest levels of state government. And it's not just lip service. He is actively working with us to figure out, to understand these challenges and how to fix them. With Mayor Biskupski, who is working so hard and tirelessly putting herself out there to work to address these challenges to the county and to our, you know, it's not just the speaker, but all in the state legislature who are recognizing that this isn't a Salt Lake City problem, it's not a Salt Lake County problem, but it belongs to all of us, and we can and will do better.
Thank you very much, Representative Romero.
Hey, Ben took all my lines there. I'm Representative Angela Romero, and two of the homeless shelter sites will be located on the eastern end of my district, and so that's why I was asked to serve on the panel. I also serve on Workforce Services and Economic Development, and most of the bills that have addressed homelessness and how we're going to build our homeless resource centers have went through my particular committee. We're not only looking at building homeless resource centers, but we're also looking about how can we support the county and the city in ensuring that people have affordable housing. We recognize that this is not just a Salt Lake City or a Salt Lake County issue, this is a state issue. And so as we move forward, yes, Salt Lake City stepped up, but where is the rest of the state? Another concern that I have, and many of my constituents have, is we're addressing this issue, and maybe we're just putting a band-aid, and we need to really look at some other systemic issues on why people are homeless to begin with, and how do we ensure that people don't land up in that situation. I think many times when we think about homeless, we think about the individuals we see at Rio Grande, and many times people don't have sympathy for that particular population in our community, but there are people, no one's disposable, but there are a lot of invisible people that we don't see. And so there are a lot of people that are living day to day that we don't see out there on Rio Grande that are in the homeless shelters or are close to being in homeless shelters. And so I think those are the forgotten people. Those are the people that we don't sometimes think about when we're talking about these homeless resource centers. Another reason why I was asked to serve on the panel is I also sit on executive offices and criminal justice. And so we as an appropriation committee are looking at how can we support services that are going to the county, but also how do we ensure that we're separating people who are truly homeless, who have some dependencies that need the help, and also drug dealers. There are people that mix in with our homeless populations down there. So how do we separate people who truly need services and individuals who are preying on our most vulnerable. And so that's kind of my presentation. I'll head it over to Speaker. And I'd like to request Medicaid expansion, but I don't know if he'll listen to that.
We couldn't wait for us to just get our introductions out before. I'm a little under the weather. I don't usually get sick during the session, but I picked up something this weekend. I apologize, but
that's where I got sick from.
See, yeah, no, I got it from Angela's. What happened? So, I work downtown. We're citizen legislators. We were in session for about 7.5 weeks, but we have day jobs. We have other, this isn't how we pay our bills, or it's not our main profession. And so I'm a downtown daytime resident, and I've seen the homeless situation grow over the years. And I was invited to come down and, as a policymaker, come down and spend some time in the Rio Grande area in Pioneer Park. And I was dressed in a suit one day, just like this. And I was with a gentleman, Bill Evans, who many of us may know, and an officer, Fred Ross, who's a fully uniformed police, Salt Lake City police officer. And we were just, it was, like I said, it was a rainy day, and we were walking around, and just, I was familiarizing myself with some of the services there and things that were going on. And within about 25 minutes of being out there, someone came up and said to the to Officer Ross that there was someone selling stolen cell phones. So he went over and asked the guy what he was doing and shooed him away. And then some young people came driving in the car very slowly as if they were looking to buy something. Imagine that. I don't know what they must have been looking for. And Fred Ross, he's a neighbor of mine, by the way. I've known him for years. But he told him to move along. And then at the end, there was an assault. And someone hit someone over the head with a pipe. And Officer Ross had to leave us and had to run across the street. And I remember as that was happening, and there was this pretty bad moment, that there was a stroller within, from me to you, from this crime that I'm seeing. And so that's three crimes I've seen on a rainy day. People are probably cleared out, not as populated as it would usually be. And they apprehended this gentleman that hit the guy in the head with a pipe, and he had hundreds of balloons of heroin in his backpack. And it was a sobering moment for me. I mean, I could be a Fed for all anyone knows. I'm in a suit. I mean, I don't blend into this community. It's right across the street. I'm with a fully uniformed officer. With another guy with a suit on, and these crimes are happening around us in real time without pause. And I think that's the epiphany that I went through, and I just thought, there's a lot of benevolence and a lot of people that, I'm just pissed, okay? I am. I'm angry about it. And I'm angry that there are children in this area, okay? And it was then that I decided that this is not a Salt Lake City issue, and it is not a county issue. It's a state issue. It's a, if you're a public servant, it's an issue. And I have to be careful though, because and when you get in the legislature, everything's geography. When Senator Urquhart was in the legislature, he was part of the Sunshine Caucus, and that's the people that live in that Washington County and Southern Utah area. You have people that live in the Davis County, Weber area. You have Salt Lake County. And I'm the Speaker of the House. The Senate President is also from Salt Lake County. And we could fall into a narrative pretty quickly that maybe a Senate President and a Speaker are carrying water just for their city or their county, respective county, and people could start to get provincial. And I didn't want that. So one of the things that I worked very hard to do, and last year we passed this bill, it was $28 million for facilities. I asked our majority whip, Francis Gibson, who's from Mableton, Utah County, to spearhead this effort and run the bill. If you don't know, Representative Wilson, he used to play defensive end for BYU. He's 6'6".
Gibson.
Yeah, I don't think Wilson. 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 He definitely didn't play football for anyone. Representative Gibson is. He is my majority whip. He's in our leadership team, and he is a Coke machine with arms and legs. He's a big guy, and no one better to whip votes, but particularly this issue, to really emphasize the fact that this is not provincial. This is not a Salt Lake County or a city issue. This is a state issue. That's where we began last year in this effort. It has been hard. These are my partners in this effort right here, and we're all different. You saw it, you have a political subdivision in our city that's grappling with this problem and with Chief Brown, and you have a county with Sheriff Winder, and you have the county's matrix, and you have us in the state trying to provide our role. And it's as was said, it's something that we all believe we should be doing, but it is really, really hard to move something like this forward. And I've heard from the people, show of hands of who would like one of these resource centers in their neighborhoods. And, well, go get a note, or go write that down, because we need, thank you very much. There's some people that are stepping forward. The issue is a hard one. If your political calculus is to not make people mad so that they like you, like what Senator Dabakis said, you don't do anything. If you don't do anything, you're never going to make anyone mad. And there are people that look to maneuver a circuitous route through their political time, trying not to make people angry. This is an issue that is going to evoke emotion. We are trying very hard to match our priorities. We're trying to get sites that we can embrace and that we can believe in. I don't believe what you see in the homeless area right now in that Rio Grande area. You're going to get that times four with these resource centers. I think we have some areas that are providing care, YWCA. There's a lot, Palmer Court, there's a lot of places amongst us right now that we don't feel such a detrimental impact to our communities. And I believe these resource centers and the way that they are being planned and will provide service for our community will not have the impact that we've seen currently. And so we're trying to get this right. And there is, I know that there's a caveat that we can start to blame one another. I'm really not interested in it. I really am not. I don't want to point a single finger at a single jurisdiction or effort here. I'll just talk plainly about what I see and what we're grappling with. And I can't wait to answer the questions, but really we'll be halfway through this session on Wednesday. And our constitutional authority will end in 45 calendar days. We'll have 23 left. And I don't have a lot of time. So I don't have a lot of time to spend commiserating or laying blame. We've got to move forward, and we've got to do it very, very quickly. And so I'm looking forward to that and would love the support of our stakeholders to do it.
Okay. Thank you all. Thank you for those framing comments. I think they were great to frame the issue. I appreciate the humanity of your responses. It's great. But, you know, we don't move forward by just talking about the things we agree on. So let's talk about some things we might disagree on, or let's talk about some things where we need our partners to help us out. So I want to ask, I'm going to ask each of you pointed questions, and I want you to tell me about the situation and where you need help. So Mayor Biskupski, I'm going to start with you. Okay. I'm going to go in the same order I did with you. I went down, heavens, it wasn't too long ago, about a month ago, and was just shocked by what I saw. I mean, a lot of lawlessness, open drug dealing. The business owners are very frustrated, property owners. We're seeing people who, you know, their lives are just, they're in great peril. This is in Salt Lake City. What is going on? What is the situation? If you can paint a picture for the extent, you know, what are we seeing in terms of drug usage, in terms of crime, or the numbers going up? And then, what are your obstacles? And now I hope y'all do talk about, because the next round is, okay, how do we come together? But what do you need the other governmental entities to do that they're not currently doing to help you deal with those issues?
So part of what the city knows is that when we created Operation Diversion to come at the issues in the road home from a very different place, we had to have funding for treatment beds set aside, and we had to have funding for jail beds set aside in order for this pilot program to even get off the ground. Those beds are staying full, and the hard part is the jail bed space is not available. So we can keep the treatment side going through some governmental funding, but right now we don't have space to really hold criminals accountable, like we did during this program that we launched to test our theories and see if we were accurate, that if we came at this differently and we separated the criminal element out from the homeless population, that we would know who was who. So that's probably our biggest issue if we're talking about the lawless nature of the area down near the road home. And we have, you know, 1,300 people still staying in that neighborhood at night, and then during the day they're out on the street, and that's a very large number of people to hide amongst if you are a criminal who is dealing drugs. And as the speaker said, there's only so much we can do as law enforcement to hold people accountable if there is no jail space. You can book them, but I worked for the sheriff for a very long time, and I know that that's the end of that, that they get booked and then released, and that's not very helpful.
Okay, so Mayor McAdams, this is the festivus part of our evening, so the airing of grievances. The city, they're having difficulties policing the area now. They're just seizing an incredible amount of drugs, more than ever. They're spending a lot of money on this. They say that they're having difficulties because people know that they can't be arrested for using drugs, and so that is recruiting people to the area, that if they know that they can use drugs with impunity in Salt Lake City, then they're going to come from all over to do that. And so what's your response to that? And then continuing with our Festivus tradition, you can point to who you need help with your issues.
Well, I think, you know, we have immense challenges in the Rio Grande area, and they've been ever more pronounced even in the last couple of years. And one of the things that, you know, I like to hold up as a success is the work that we did with Operation Diversion. Sheriff Winder approached me with this idea early in the summer and said, look, we've been looking at this population downtown and what we might be able to do to try to break some of the drug trade and crime that we're seeing there. And he you know, walked me through it, showed me some of the stuff that they were seeing. And they see people who will take a four-hour shift of selling drugs, and in exchange, at the end of their four-hour shift, they get a hit. And so these are people who are suffering from mental illness and substance use disorder, and they will take those drugs and sell them, and then take a hit at the end of the day. And as soon as we arrest that person,
Mayor, let me interrupt. Is your mic on?
It is on.
Okay. There we go. All right.
It's just not very loud. Okay.
Sorry.
Do you want me to trade with somebody?
No, it's good.
Go ahead. Okay. Just stay close.
All right. We see these people being arrested and taken to jail, and there are 10 people in line behind them, eager for the chance to, you know, the person going to jail is happy to have a warm bed and a meal. And there are 10 people in line behind, ready to take a four-hour shift and get a free hit at the end. And so that's been one of the challenges. And we said, how do we can arrest all of these people, and there are going to be 10 more in line to do that. And we can spend millions of dollars in taxes locking these people up and never make a dent in the situation. So Sheriff Winder approached me with this concept for Operation Diversion, where he said, we're going to understand the problem. And I, you know, I don't want to get into some of the specifics of law enforcement, but some intelligence they had captured on how to really get at the root of this, and said, what we want to do is we want to lock up people who are making our streets unsafe. These are the hardened criminals who are making our streets unsafe. For these people who are addicted to drugs, or there's a mental illness that's driving their addiction, you know, and we see almost 70% of those who are criminally involved have a substance use disorder and or mental illness. And so he said, those are the people we want to offer. If we have an option for them that is treatment, then we'll lock them up and prosecute them to the fullest extent of the law, but offer that to them as an alternative if they want to some relief from the criminal penalties. If they want to enter into treatment, that's what we want to do for them, because we can lock these people up for years. They won't get better. Our communities won't get safer. We want to get those people into treatment, really cut into demand side of the equation on this, of reducing the demand by getting people healthy and getting them back into the community and integrated into the community. So we proposed Operation Diversion. We put $1.2 million of county funding on the table to fund. The most expensive part is the treatment, because treatment isn't just a one-day operation. The treatment is a 6 to 9 month endeavor for the people who will stick with it, to get them to a place where they are healed enough to really be stable and have a degree of self-reliance. So $1.2 million of county funding on the table for treatment. And then additional funding, Salt Lake City matched that with about, I think it was $150,000 of city dollars to help with the operation, and the county then collaboration between the city police officers, the sheriff's office, county behavioral health, and other services, and we launched Operation Diversion. I think that while it was limited in time, it has been a success. So I think one of the things we know going forward is, yes, we do need additional jail beds, but jail beds alone, we can't build enough or fund enough to really make a dent in the problem. If we want to make a dent in the problem, we need to have treatment options as well. And so that's really where the focus has been on the conversation. Since my conversation with the sheriff last summer is proving out this concept, seeing if the ideas would really play out. When we took Operation Diversion to Salt Lake City, asked for their support, and we entered into that partnership on Operation Diversion, we think it's been a success. And our data is showing that Operation Diversion has been successful. And the whole plan of realigning homeless services, while it's very many aspects to it, including realignment of shelter services, but to really get at the root of the problems of what we're seeing in the Rio Grande, we must have significant treatment options. And those treatment options, what we believe, are somewhat toothless if we don't have the ability to follow through on criminal penalties for those who choose to violate the law and use drugs in our communities. And oftentimes it's not the drug users themselves that are making our communities unsafe. They're making our communities unsanitary, unseemly, but it's the drug dealers that are making our communities unsafe. So we want to get upstream to those drug dealers who are bringing in an international drug cartel that's operating in our city, crack down on drug dealing, and get users who are sick and need help into treatment where they can be better off, and we want them to heal and to become, again, productive members of our society.
Mayor, if I may, to and I appreciate your statesmanship, but to get you into the spirit of Festivus, can you explain JRI, what it briefly is, and the effect that had on your ability to provide jail beds, processing, treatment, and what you need help with on that?
Sure.
Because so, this round, it really is to talk about what we need our partners to do, and we'll come together after this.
Well, so 2 years ago, the legislature took a bold step, and one that was supported widely supported, including myself, to say, looking at the analysis, we are sending far too many people in this state to the state prison. We're incarcerating, and we actually see this in the county jail too, because at the time there was the Justice Reinvestment Initiative, Salt Lake County did an in-depth analysis of our jail and jail services as well. And what we see is that if you have mental illness, you are going to be incarcerated for twice as long as someone who doesn't have mental illness. Now there are reasons, I don't think we're intentionally saying we're going to incarcerate the mentally ill, but someone who is mentally ill doesn't follow behavioral norms in the prison or the jail. They're put in isolation. They don't pass their parole hearings. Their sentences are extended. But it really is a travesty that we're going to look back on in 50, 75 years and look at that time in American history where we incarcerated the mentally ill rather than recognizing the biological nature of their illness and treating it appropriately. So JRI was a bold step forward of saying, look, we recognize that we're locking people up who are sick. And not only is that inhumane, it's incredibly expensive to the taxpayers, and we must reform our criminal justice system. So legislature passed legislation taking many of these felony offenses for drug possession. Possession of small amounts of drugs was a crime for which you'd have a felony, and a felony means prison time. And we reclassified these prison sentences to misdemeanor crimes, which meant instead of spending years in jail, they would spend weeks to months in the years in prison, the state-funded prison system, they'd spend weeks to months in the county-funded jail system. And what we saw then was really a shift of those people out of the state correction system into the county correction system, almost 7,000 people that we're looking at who came into the county correction system. And then there was talk about we needed to fund a treatment option for these individuals. If they're not going to be in state prison, they need to be in treatment. And so there was debate about how treatment would be handled. And this dovetailed into a much broader debate about Obamacare and Medicaid expansion. And I was a proponent of Obamacare because of there were 94,000 individuals in our state who do not have health insurance, but 7,000 of those 94,000 are this JRI population. Actually, 21,000 of those 94,000 are criminal justice involved and suffer from a behavioral health or substance use disorder. So those 21,000. Many of those 21,000 have access to treatment under Medicaid, but about 7,000 are uncovered in any way, not even through the traditional Medicaid system. So we saw these people leaving the state prison system and hitting our streets without treatment. Now, Medicaid expansion would have been a way to cover these individuals. That became a very political conversation, and there was not support in the state legislature for Medicaid expansion. There was a fallback plan, and the fallback plan was an extension of Medicaid benefits. So JRI passed 2 years ago. Last year, the legislature passed an extension of Medicaid benefits that would have covered about 10,000, 9,000 to 10,000 of the poorest of the poor individuals in the state, and that would have covered this homeless population. So Mayor Biskupski and I both stepped forward and supported this plan. While I think both of us would have loved to see a full Medicaid expansion, I had a hard time saying no to something that would provide treatment to this population that we saw coming at us from the Justice Reinvestment Initiative. Speaker Hughes supported that Medicaid extension that would cover those individuals, and it would need a waiver from the Federal Department of Health and Human Services. So that proposal passed the legislature last session, and our state government engaged in talks with the Department of HHS in DC to receive the waiver necessary to get those funds flowing. And the waivers weren't forthcoming. In fact, we were very disappointed to see that the administration ended the term without approving those waivers. We felt that those waivers were reasonable. I get that I was with them, that I would love to see more, not less, of expansion towards Medicaid, but those waivers weren't approved. And so that's where we are today, is 7,000 people with no access to coverage in our system today, and that's to a large extent. When people say, what happened in the last 2 years for it to get where it is, it's that we have those people on the streets with no means for treatment. And so that's where our conversations over the last 6 months have led, and we've had very productive conversations with both Speaker Hughes and Senate President Niederhauser about how we can get access to treatment for those very individuals.
Okay, thank you. We're working through several of our questions.
Can I take a... Saturday.
Yeah, I'm gonna get to you in 1 second. We're working through several of our questions, and many of those were we need jail beds, we need treatment beds. So, Mayor McAdams, you agree we need county jail beds, treatment beds. Part of that, you think, is the state passed JRI, the state needs to come through and help fund
That's right.
those beds. Okay, so that turns to the state, Representative Romero, and the role of JRI and the state's responsibilities to fund jail and treatment.
I also want to remind our mayors that there might be a president and a speaker, but there's also a minority leader in both chambers as well. And so it's important to include us in those conversations. We might be 13 and 5, but we still are an important voice in that conversation as well. I think sometimes we're often overlooked because you know, we're in that space. And so I just want to remind everyone that although we may not be in the majority, that doesn't mean we don't have influence sometimes with the majority. Just want to put that out. When it comes to, I did not support, I want to put that on record, that I did not support the bill we proposed. I felt like we need to expand Medicaid all the way because my district would benefit the most, and I'm also having two of these shelters in my district. And so for me, this conversation is not just about JRI, it's about looking at why people land up in the situations they do. And so a good bulk of this, we could talk about JRI, but we also need to talk about affordable housing. We also need to talk about services that support people So they're not displaced and they're not going to shelters. I know many, many people, including myself when I was a young person, who lived in public housing, who received food stamps, and I'm here today sitting on the stage, but that's because I had support. And so a lot of times we don't invest our money where we should, where we can support people so they don't land up in a homeless situation or they don't land up locked up. And so for me, the mental health, as Mayor McAdams mentioned, is a critical piece to this, but we also have to think about we're always talking about how we fix these issues instead of how we prevent these issues. And so I'd like to start there before we're even at this conversation.
Thank you. So Speaker Hughes, you did a good job earlier of talking about why this is a statewide issue. It's been raised that the state has responsibilities to help pay for treatment and possibly jail. And let me emphasize, when we talk about jail, as I understand the plan, it's because there is a criminal element that preys on the homeless. So we need to decide who's going to jail. But then also, even for a lot of the homeless population, if they are breaking laws, the jail and processing can be the first step to assessment to move them into treatment. So Speaker Hughes, what is the state's responsibility here? What is the state prepared to do to help out?
So in the 2015 session, when we looked at justice reform, I think Mayor McAdams articulated it well. We had people that are addicted and they were going to our correctional facilities, and it's a costly way to handle society's problems and these individuals' problems, and it wasn't necessarily effective. And you saw our recidivism rates were going up. It was a graduate school for criminality for many who may have found themselves addicted more than anything else. There's a larger issue going on in society, and it's our opiate addictions that's going on. There's a true crisis. If I showed you a heat map from 2002 till today, and reddest being the most deaths going on, you would see a state that was yellow or even white in 2002 to a crimson red statewide today in terms of the deaths, overdoses of prescription drugs. And so this thing is, I was at a speaker's conference last September, and this is hitting every state. This isn't unique to just the state of Utah. And as I sat with the DEA agent from Utah, 80%, he says, of the heroin users and addicts started on the prescription drugs. And so there's a big issue happening there that is creating the people that are addicted, and it wasn't the best way. So justice reform needed to happen, and there's a lot of good leadership in rolling out this reform. We had a fiscal note. We asked for the counties and those that would implement justice reform to tell us how much would it cost to fully implement this. One way was through the through the Medicaid expansion of the governor's Healthy Utah. And that was it for its own reasons and probably a different debate. Was not going to receive the support from the House. But the other one was that there was about $14 million of ongoing funds that was asked of the state legislature to fund, particularly those who would need the treatment. And so we fully funded our justice reform bill that year. That was about a year and a half ago. Now I want to remind everyone that we've had this homeless problem in Salt Lake City for longer than 18 months. Okay, so let's not pretend that JRI, before that, everything was rosy. I mean, we have a mounting problem, but we've had this longer than just this JRI discussion. Last year, there was a request to, as you roll out any reform, you're gonna learn from it, and you're gonna find that there's that the dollars might not be arriving. Now, it can't be a wipeout, because if it is, I need to know where that $14.7 million ongoing is going, because their counties are receiving those dollars, and there was about $6 million more last year ongoing, and there's a request for $21 million this year. There's $5 million that we want to put in place, and another $16 million that's being requested. So it's not like we're not paying our bills on the state side on this JRI. We're trying to get this right. You've got a lot of other factors. Another part that was mentioned was traditional Medicaid expansion, and that's what Representative Dunnigan passed last year, said for the homeless, those exiting jail, and then if there were any dollars left, we set aside or found $30 million on the state side to leverage $70 more million of federal dollars for traditional Medicaid that would help this very population we're talking about. Medicaid expansion in Healthy Utah is up to 140% of poverty. This is 0% poverty. These are our homeless and those leaving jail and potentially needing this care and help. $100 million we could bring to bear with the $70 million from the feds and $30 million from the state. We were on conference calls with Health and Human Services, CMS. Representative Dunnigan worked very, very hard to talk to the administration, the Obama administration, to make sure that the waivers we would ask for were not unrealistic. And we were given what we felt were indication that these were waivers that other states had received. And so we set aside our $30 million, and we did not see those waivers approved. And at the very end, in December, at the very end of this last administration, they granted two waivers. One was the primary care network was reauthorized, and then adults with dependent children. So we have CHIP, which we don't have any cap on, and children, if they need the health care, we provide it. Any adults that have dependent children, the waiver was for this Medicaid expansion to cover those adults. So that helps about 4,500 people and takes them off the PCN rules, which allows more people to be helped on the PCN, primary care network. But that still won't do what $100 million of a bill that we passed last year could have brought to bear. And I feel that without those waivers granted and without that legislation being fully implemented, it does put that voice, that problem, or that challenge back on the state, of which we haven't blinked and we are looking to work through and work with the resources we have. We have a brand new administration. We have within our legislative body planned conference calls with the new Health and Human Services Secretary, and we are trying to find out in the early stages of this administration if those waivers that are still pending, because they weren't denied, if those waivers would be granted, or if not, what can be done. So we're working on those things. But we did spend of the $30 million, just so you know, about $7.5 million of those dollars we set aside are being used and bringing more services to people that are in need, the way I described. Let me talk about the prisons and the jail beds. So I became, as I described, aware that we need to start arresting people and we need to start putting people away. And there is the Operation Diversion, which I participated in, did a ride along with, and there was the question asked, would you like treatment or would you like to go to jail? 40% asked to be for treatment, 60% preferred jail. But I'm interested in the people five blocks away that are filling these backpacks with balloons of heroin. And I'm interested in the people that are bringing those into this area. And I'm interested in the people that are living in the apartments higher up above the ground, looking at the patterns of the law enforcement as they're walking and patrolling this area. So I asked Representative Noel from Kane County. He is one that over the years has been very passionate about jail contracting. Find me 300 beds. I need 300 beds. And he has gone to work and believes that he has found a way for us to appropriate dollars. And they're gonna be Greg Hughes beds, by the way. They're not parole and probation. They're not through the normal trip. These are gonna be beds that our county, Salt Lake County, could hopefully transfer people to Uinta Basin or Tooele, but leave county beds open finally so we can start seeing incarceration occur and see arrests happen. And we're gonna do that very quickly. So that's something I can get my arms around and I can go and work on and get done, and we're going to do that. The other issue with the DEA, this is something I'm advocating for as Speaker and our legislature is, but in meeting with the DEA, they have a grant called DEA 360. Other metropolitan areas receive that grant, and it goes as high up as the physicians that are abusive in their prescription of opiates, as well as public awareness and then also law enforcement, but they need additional agents. And they're even if on a temporary basis. So I'm working very closely with Senator Hatch's office. He's in a unique role right now with this new administration. His chief of staff now works in the Oval Office, Rob Porter. So I'm working on that to try and bring to bear those resources on a federal level that I think would, I'm told by Chief Winder and the DEA here in Utah, can make a big difference in a very quick way. So we're looking at the care, the justice reform. We're looking to fund that. We know the challenges we have in front of us there. But I am also interested in the law enforcement side of it and doing what I can to help Sheriff Winder, Chief Brown, and our law enforcement start arresting people that are particularly the higher level criminals, the wolves that I would argue are preying upon society's most vulnerable, which is happening in real time.
Okay, that's fantastic. So I'm going to ask both of our mayors what that would do to your abilities if the state were to help open 300 beds, how that would change things. But first, Speaker, let me press you a little on this, which I love this position. I have no bills, no appropriations requests, which you can kill. So, okay, so what is the backup plan? If we can't reach an agreement with the administration, if federal money doesn't come, what is the... Jails, you addressed that. What about treatment? Can the state do something?
So of that $30 million, this gets wonkish in the weeds, but there was a hospital assessment of that $30 million that was $13 million of that amount. The way the legislation was written, in hindsight, we probably would have written it differently, but the way the legislation was written for the $13 million in hospital assessment, it was contemplating all the waivers passing or being approved. If all the waivers were approved that we had requested, we would be able to access $13 million through a hospital assessment. Because only two of those waivers were approved, that $13 million is not available to the legislature. We have spent $7.5 million so far on the reauthorization of PCN and the adults with dependent children. We are willing to leverage the difference of those dollars we set aside to work with the counties and to work to provide the behavioral health care that is needed out there. And so I'd like to see that traditional Medicaid, that 70-30 match, I'd like to see a solution, Steve, on that front. But absent that, we do have some of those dollars still available that were appropriated, that were not are not committed, that we could use to leverage in a smart way.
Great, thank you. Mayor McAdams, you heard the state's plan there, state's offer. What would that do to your ability to execute the plan?
Yeah, well, thank you. I think, first of all...
Hey, Ben, your mic just isn't working. We're
yeah,
going
okay.
to do something there.
You might get her cooties back.
There we go. Is that better? Okay. I think, first of all, jail beds would be incredibly important. And I just want to caution that jail beds without treatment beds is simply just reversing the JRI. And we do want treatment beds. And I'm not questioning the commitment of the legislature to do that. But so I think that's probably necessary. So the jail beds would make a big difference. And if we're not going to provide treatment beds, then that's the reality, is those people are better off incarcerated than they are on the street suffering, and our communities are better off. But what a sad place that would be after we took the bold steps of JRI to not, and we took a bold first step, but we've got to take the additional steps for that to succeed. And I'm hopeful that we aren't talking about going back to the old way of just warehousing people, but let's move forward boldly with funding taking the next few steps, and that is treatment. And so I think our experience with Operation Diversion is that a treatment bed is a toothless offer if we don't have the ability to follow through on incarceration for people who are breaking the law and making our communities unsafe. So I think that offer of what the speaker's been working on as it relates to jail beds is commendable and is an important part of the solution. We've got to have the treatment beds also, and I believe he's there. We talked about when the state passed the JRI, there was some commitment, and Greg, I'd love to go over this maybe with you in detail. I'm not going to go over a big sheet here in this meeting, but the state did appropriate about $14 million to the counties to assist with some of the expenses that would be passed to the counties as a result of JRI. After that goes through funding to state trainings for treatment providers, certification of database systems, develop AP&P, including treatment staff and other things, it resulted in about $1.4 million trickling down to Salt Lake County. So as you might imagine, with 7,000 people coming to Salt Lake County, 1.4 didn't go very far. In fact, what we did with it is we launched a program, a Core 2 treatment program. This helps women who are substance addicted and criminal justice involved. We opened a treatment bed that we opened last summer for about 16 women. that stay anywhere from several months to, I think, up to a year. It's a very successful evidence-based program that there are 16 beds for. But we took, of that $1.4 million of state funding, we put $750,000 of that state funding towards that, matched it with about $1.1 million of county funding, additional county funding to fund that 16-bed treatment facility. So it doesn't go very far. We look at the needs. So if we come up with the jail beds, that would be important. But we see still needs a gap of about $16 million to fund treatment for those 7,000 people who are coming to us from the JRI. And those numbers are pretty conservative numbers. It's a per-person amount on the treatment that's been funded under the current system. We'd love to see a more robust treatment system as we start to develop evidence-based practices and know what it's going to take to get people healthy. What the historical numbers may be low numbers, and that's what's averaged out across the population. That $16 million also does not include expenses that would come to the county as a result of prosecution, of course incarceration, but help with the jail beds would assume that cost, case management, parole, supervision, other factors that the county's willing to, with a proposal that we're discussing right now, willing to assume some of those costs, because I think we all see the vision of JRI. It's a vision that I'm very much committed to. I think it would be a travesty to go back to the way things were. But we've got to continue to move forward implementing the next steps of JRI.
Can I say one thing real quick?
Yes.
Real quick. So, to be clear, the 300 jail beds, that's we came up with that number talking to Sheriff Winder and the DEA. And we're really looking at the higher level criminals that we want to address. But then, to Mayor McAdams' point, you have to have, it is toothless to say, would you like treatment or incarceration if you're not going to be able to do that. But I'm not really interested in the people that are for the jail beds and for the crime to stop and for the predators to be taken away. I'm after them. And that's where I would like to see that focus. But I don't want to go back in time that way. Some of the numbers that are being shared on the JRI, the Utah Association of Counties, they keep giving us the invoice and we keep paying it. So when you give us these numbers, I'm getting them from the same place that they've come for the last 2 years. And we try to fully fund what it is that we're trying to roll out. And, as we roll it out, we learn new things. But I just want to be clear that we haven't shortchanged this effort. We've taken the fiscal note that the Association of Counties have provided to the legislature, and we have funded it. And so it's not when we talk about the scarcity of funds, the Association of Counties has to give us what that number is.
Yeah, and we've had conversations with them. We think they lowballed it before, and that was frustrating for us. But to your credit, you did fund the invoice that was given to you.
Yeah.
Mayor Biskupski.
So I don't know if the sheriff and the DA are thinking countywide or Salt Lake City in particular, but I know that all of the communities in the county are needing jail space, and that if there's some sort of prioritizing going on for Salt Lake City, that sometimes that doesn't play so well for Salt Lake City. So I'm not sure how this plays out, but we certainly need a tool to hold people accountable and to help those who are addicted to give them options. And when they have an option between a jail bed and a treatment bed, they often take the treatment bed. And I think that's an important piece to this. But I will also say that our community connection center has referred 200 people for services in our city since they opened up this summer. And those are people who are coming through the door and asking for help. And I think that's an important piece. And the city will fund some additional social workers to help ramp that effort up. But it's only a piece of this. And as you can see clearly, all levels of government need to be working on this from multiple angles. And this is a very complex, difficult issue to resolve. But at the end of the day, if we who are in charge of certain government entities or running certain departments are working toward an end goal of getting people the help they need, providing services in a new fashion, dispersing those funds that are currently in this system that appears to be broken and not really serving the people who are experiencing homelessness today, I think we will shake loose some of the funding we're talking about. And I will continue to always say, we have got to keep moving forward and reallocating the funds that are currently in the pool.
Thank you. Before we move on to the next phase, Representative Romero, do you have anything more to add to this round?
I think
we're both sick, so if you see me massaging my head, I have like head congestion or cold. We've been trying to address this through our appropriation committee, through executive offices and criminal justice, so this is something that's really important to us. And many of us know those who have drug dependencies, and I know this because my mother had one for a long time. It takes a long time for people to really want to receive that help, and so they're going to fall down, and we're going to have to be there to pick them back up. And when they fall down again, we need to be there to pick them back up, and it's an investment. And so I agree with Mayor McAdams, and I agree with the speaker. We have to get rid of the source, but we also have to address the issue. And we really need to look at trauma. And I sound like a broken record here, but we need to look before we even get to having this conversation about homelessness and affordable housing. We need to look at how do people get there. And I think sometimes we don't have that conversation, and we just try to fix things instead of solving things.
Thank you very well, sir. Okay, so we've addressed this many questions, and there are more questions that won't be addressed. What I will do is, there are so many good questions, I will hand them to the person in particular they apply to. What are you doing about mental health treatment? That obviously is a very important part of this. What about the systemic inequities, such as wages, healthcare, childcare, that lead to people being vulnerable to homelessness in the first place? These are awesome. What I mainly shot for were the questions that dealt with the interjurisdictional issues that they have to work on. So again, my fault if I asked the wrong questions. But to wrap it up, here's a great question. If you could each take 2 minutes on this, then we'll end when we said we would end, and I imagine you'll stay around and answer some questions. Think about this from your responsibilities, your jurisdiction, what you need to do. What is the greatest need? I think this is a good human element to end on. What is the greatest need among the homeless population, and how can we be effectively involved as citizens? So what is the greatest need among the homeless population, and how can we be effectively involved as citizens? So how can your citizens be involved? And I'm going to point that to you have serious responsibilities. How can they be involved on their own, but also how can they be involved in helping you work through what you need to do? Let's reverse the order on this. Let's start with the speaker and then Representative Romero, Mayor McAdams, Mayor Biskupski.
So for me, basically, I need the sites for these resource centers to be landed on and supported by the community. And we need a county that's willing to help staff and operate these facilities. And we need to step up our efforts on the law enforcement side so that it's working on all fronts. And I really do believe that if we can find, and it's difficult because I've had a lot of meetings in my office with people that are still unhappy about the site locations. There's still worry about the pro formas. One of the things I didn't mention is we have a representative that has a bill that looks to the state. If it's a state issue and you have a jurisdiction and you're not providing homeless resources or help, there's a statewide, at least a contemplated assessment. And for those jurisdictions that do provide these resources, there would be funds that would be provided for them, and maybe it's an incentive for other jurisdictions to be involved in this at a higher level. We have the Lantern House in Ogden. We have some great programs in Provo and even in St. George. So there's a look at doing that, but we do need, as tough of an issue as this is, we need community support. And I'm not someone that lives in Draper and just watches this from afar. Where I go to work every day is on 200 West, and well, I shouldn't tell you,
they're going to
exit me or something, but I'm sandwiched between two of these proposed sites, I'll just say that. And I think I live this, I think I see this, and so I'm not preaching from afar here. I think we have to be ready to help and support the decisions, the tough decisions we've asked our leaders to make. Look, I went to Jackie and the council and I said, we reappropriated $9 million for facilities and to buy land. If we get into this next session and we don't have sites selected, I don't know that my colleagues with the high competition and the high demand on dollars will see without any progress made. The next 9 point something million, 18 million more that's supposed to come over the next 2 years, I don't know that we can hang on to that if we don't have measurables and something to show what's happened in the last year. So I said to Salt Lake City, you have to have sites. And we were saying this in the late fall, and it puts a lot of stress on the city. It puts a lot of stress on the stakeholders to get to these solutions. And we all feel it. We all feel whether we felt the process was long enough or transparent enough or whatever, but there's a lot of moving parts here. And so I have a lot of respect for the city stepping forward and making some of these really difficult decisions. Why four sites? Why would you go into four separate communities? They're looking to make them smaller, where those that would prey upon them would be more obvious. If you have women and children in a facility, you don't see people that would be, if people tried to come and sell drugs and to steal from them or whatever's going on, it will be harder. And I think those resource centers with that are smaller are meant to move people to self-reliance and give them hope. And it's not the permanent residence. It's a way to move forward and upward. Anyway, so those are hard. Those are hard decisions to make and hard things to do. And it's a long answer, but we could use the community support in those things I just described.
Thank you, Representative Romero.
And I know Speaker Hughes is, and I'm not trying to suck up to him, but I know he's committed to this issue. He and I have had these conversations, and he is my constituent when he's at work. But I also, like I said, I will have two of the sites in my district. On my eastern end of my district, on my western end of my district, I have all our parole violators. And so I've seen my district step up and carry a lot for the state and for the city and for the county. And I'll be working down the street from one of the facilities right by my office, and obviously house is right there too. And so for me, it's about what is right for all in our community. And maybe some people are questioning why in my neighborhood. Well, you know, my neighborhood asks that question all the time, but you know what, we persevere, we stand up for everyone. But what I'd like to see as a policymaker is this is not about the county, the city, the state. This is about us as Utahns and how we take care of all our community. And when I go to these community council meetings, where they're, you know, I'm there listening to the city talking about the sites, but what a lot of people have questions about is what are the programs that are going to be offered there. So what I'd love to see would be for the county to partner with the city and us as the state when we're going to these community councils, so we can give kind of a whole picture of what we plan on doing. Because when you're talking about sites, but you're not talking about the programming you're doing, I think that's why you see a lot of people say, well, I don't know if I want this. And so for me, this is about us as Utahns stepping up. We as Salt Lake City and Salt Lake County have said, hey, we're going to take the initial shot here. But then I think this will spread out to other municipalities. I hope people will step up, because this isn't just a Salt Lake City issue or Salt Lake County issue. This is a Utah issue, and maybe people have concerns. But at the end of the day, as I said this when we talked about the prison, nobody's disposable, and it's our responsibility to make sure that everyone has the services they need. And so although I might have two of the sites in my district, I'm willing to take the pressure of that and to make sure that people have a safe place to be. You know, when we talk about a lot of people and we talk about homelessness, we're looking at Rio Grande and we're saying that's, we paint that as the face of homelessness. And that is one part of that face. But there are also, I do a lot of work in sexual violence and domestic violence. There are a lot of single moms out there who leave homes, who have nowhere to go. And the shelters where they go because they don't have a job and they're leaving a situation. So when we're talking about this issue, I want to put a human face. I don't want to put that stereotype, because that stereotype still needs support. But we also need to remember that these are people that might be us one day. These are people that might be our family members. And so when we're debating on where these sites are, and I hope we're not doing that anymore, let's put a human face on that and know that these are people just like us who want to have a safe space to live.
So my hope is that as we look to improve the services, the homeless services that we deliver, that we make decisions that are deliberate, not arbitrary, that the way that we spend tax dollars is deliberate, not arbitrary. The base of our recommendation has been that we want people who are homeless to be treated as individuals in crisis who are able to heal from that crisis, not as one-size-fits-all people who just need a meal and a bed, but people are complex. Their challenges are complex. How they got to where they are is complex. And we can't just treat them as one-size-fits-all hungry people who need a place to sleep. And so at the crux of our reform has been that we need to better understand why people are in crisis if we're going to help them to overcome crisis. And so that's led us to a data-driven approach where we are understanding very innately the nature of homelessness. And what we see is there are not just the homeless, but there are people who are homeless because of domestic violence. There are adolescents who are homeless because they aged out of foster care. There are men who are homeless because while they hold down a job, they just don't earn enough to pay first and last month's rent. They can't find housing. There are people who have a criminal conviction on their record, and while they've paid their debt to society and haven't committed a crime in years, because of that criminal record, they can't get a house. They can't get approved for an apartment. There are people who are currently addicted to drugs, who have a substance use disorder, and they need help, and they're helpable. But those are just some of the reasons why people are homeless. And if we continue to treat them as just all one-size-fits-all people who are hungry and need a place to sleep, we will never help them to overcome crisis, and we'll never help them to heal. So the crux of the recommendation is to understand the problem, to recognize it's complex, and then to try and help people, meet people where they are and help them to heal. And so because it's data-driven, because there's a lot we don't know about our system, our understanding has changed over time. The deeper and deeper we dig into it, our understanding of the system changes. And as our understanding changes, our proposals must adapt to the data that we're seeing. And so that's happened over time. As we've seen recommendations change and proposals change, we cannot fall into the trap that we fell into 30 years ago of this is the system and it's how it will always be and it will never change. So we understand the system better today. We're adapting, we're learning from ourselves. Salt Lake County launched two programs a month ago to help to address people who are criminally involved and homeless. And we're spending an additional $11.5 million just starting last month to help these same people. But in this process, part of that $11.5 million is we are funding the University of Utah to do a randomized control trial to understand whether our interventions are working, how can we do better, what's not working. That's the highest level of study of any program. It's the type of study you do for medication, understand medication. So we're understanding what services we apply to the homeless to see if it's working empirically in a data-driven fashion. As we do that, we will learn and evolve. So the county is learning from in real time. As we act and measure what we're doing and evaluate our actions, we are learning. And the same is true of our recommendations, that the recommendations that we put forward a year ago are different than the recommendations where we landed 6 months ago. And where we are today is very different than we were 6 months ago as we learn, as we understand the population and evolve. And so what I would hope from the community is, first of all, understand that we are trying to move to a more sophisticated model of helping the homeless, that they are people, they are helpable, They're members of our community. They're somebody's brother. They're somebody's sister. They're somebody's child. And we can help them, but it's going to require us to be sophisticated. What I'd ask for from the community is to recognize that as we learn, our methods of helping the homeless will evolve. So I'd ask for your patience as recommendations change, as proposals change. That is in the nature of continuous improvement and continuous learning, and that you don't that you understand that as that evolves, that's because we are getting better and moving to a higher standard and trying to make sure that every decision we make and every dollar we spend is deliberately targeted to improving people's lives and making our community safer and not just arbitrary.
Does that include us?
Mayor.
Does that include our neighborhood?
Yes.
Yes. No, seriously. Yes. Has anybody thought about us and our neighborhood?
Yes.
Mayor. We have one last question, then it's all yours.
Mayor. Can you let me respond to this?
Hold on.
It's funny that Gail Miller is contributing $8 million to this. Isn't it?
You just about made it to the end. Let's have one more statement and then we'll wrap it up.
Why don't you ask hard questions?
Sorry if I let you down. This is my fault.
We're all jerking each other off. You won't be asking questions.
Okay, Mayor Biskupski, if you can wrap this up.
Can we finish?
Why are all the shelters in Salt Lake? And if we're so hard up for money, why are you tearing down a perfectly good prison to build a new one in Salt Lake?
Yeah, that one was built in the 50s, and it needs to be repaired. It needs to be rebuilt.
You know what?
Let me tell you this. Let me give you a straight answer. Let me just give you a straight answer. You ask me a question, you want to hear an answer. Okay?
Yeah.
I just said, we're looking at a statewide assessment.
We're looking for a statewide
assessment so that some of these facilities and some that already exist can be better funded so that it isn't all in Salt Lake City. That was discussed tonight, okay? So we're looking at those solutions. We want, this isn't all just in Salt Lake City for these bills, and we have, you know, Representative Briscoe, he's another person, we're right here. He has a bill filed open. We have multiple bills that are looking at this issue. The statewide assessment would be a great way to incentivize other political subdivisions to look at having some of these facilities.
So, Mayor Biskupski, the question is what can citizens do?
So, there's a couple things that would be very helpful, and I will ask my team to make sure that all the bills on Capitol Hill that have that are tied to helping us solve this issue are on our website so that you know what is being tracked, what those bills do. I think it's very important you get informed on what is happening on Capitol Hill this session that can be of help to us. And I want you to reach out to your friends and family after you've read those bills and ask them to support, because your friends and family live all over the state and their legislators need to hear that supporting those bills is very important to you as an individual, but to this whole issue of trying to help people who experience homelessness. The other thing I will ask of you is please don't give to panhandlers, give to service providers. It is causing real problems for us. And if you have things you want to drop off down near the Rio Grande, like blankets or food, take them in to St. Vincent's or take them into the road home. Do not disperse them on the street, because oftentimes you are dispersing that to people who are actually not homeless, live in homes and come down and are doing drugs. So please give your products and your assistance to the actual service providers in that neighborhood. The other thing I will ask of you to do is what everybody else up here is saying, and that is please get information from the county about the service model so you understand the direction we are heading. It is very important for us to know that this service model is not the bed and the shelter with a roof over your head. It is very different. And we really are looking to treat people as individuals with faces, people we know, people who are family members, people that are in a tough situation for a number of reasons. Let us help them finally get back on their feet and back into self-dependent situations where they can have the life that we all dream of having. That is real. We are talking about human beings. And people who have gone through a lot of things in their lives, and yes, some with multiple barriers that maybe will never be independent. But we are also building in Salt Lake City permanent supportive housing. It's not like we aren't. And yes, it seems like Salt Lake City is doing all of it, but we aren't. Ogden has a shelter that is bigger than anything we are building, that has services tied to it. St. George has the same. Midvale has the same. Murray has raised their hand. Yes, do I want other communities with high population numbers in them to raise their hand? Absolutely, I do. Because this isn't just going to go away. You heard the speaker describe our state as bright red for drug overdose deaths in this country. We have a long way to go. There's no question. The city has raised its hand and said, we will do our part, but we can't do it all. And that's where we drew our line, is we are doing our part and we are moving as fast as we can to do our part, but we need other partners across the state to raise their hand as well.
Okay, we didn't get to about two questions per each person up here. I will distribute those. If you didn't like the answers that you heard or think they need to be changed, work with these folks, approach them. But in the meanwhile, will you please join me in giving them a round of applause for digging in on this.